Good evening, everybody. Welcome. I'm James Gitlin, physician. I want to introduce my dear friend, Dr. Noor. We're running a little late, so I can take half an hour to read you his curriculum or have him speak for us half an hour. But I'll try to go fast. Dr. Noor is a neurologist who is certified in both neurology and neurophysiology by the American Board of Psychiatry and Neurology. He holds two British degrees, member of the Royal College of Surgeons of England and licentiate of the Royal College of Physicians of London. Dr. Noor has been honored with many awards, such as Top Doctors in Chicago Metro Area, 2003, America's Top Physicians, 2005, 2006, 2009, 2010, 2017. Sure, next year will be 2018 there as well. Top Doctors in Indianapolis, 2011. The Leading Physicians of the World, 2016. Dr. Noor currently teaches neurology at the University of California, Irvine, and he was a clinical instructor at the University of Illinois College of Medicine, Rockford, for 3 years. After completing his neurology training at the prestigious Baylor College of Medicine in Texas before going into private practice. He's a member in many scientific organizations such as the American Association of the Advancement of Science, Society for Brain Mapping and Therapeutics, the American Academy of Neurology, the Royal Society of Medicine in London, the American Headache Society, and many others. Help me welcome Dr. Noor, who's going to give us the third lecture in the series of Understanding Love. Dr. Noor.
Thank you. All right. Today we will continue our march to talk about understanding love. And if you understand love, you find it. And if you find love, you find happiness. And our approach would be love explained by science. We will use physical brain science to explain love. And I know about physical brain science because I'm a neurologist. I spent all my life studying the brain and dealing firsthand with the brain, with different chemicals, diseases, and so on. We already covered in two previous presentations the first phase of love. Love always and must always start with phase one, which is mate selection. Never heard of anybody saying, oh, I'm madly in love with who? I haven't decided yet. It doesn't happen, impossible to happen. First phase, you have to select someone and decide, this is the perfect mate for me. And mate selection happens at two levels. First presentation was about how your unconscious brain selects a mate and how it happened unconsciously, automatically. It either you feel attracted to someone or you don't. You cannot make yourself get attracted to someone or stop yourself from feeling attracted to someone. This is followed by a conscious brain contribution where a conscious voluntary brain have also to agree. Once the old brain and the new brain have agreed to select a person as your perfect mate, mate selection ends, and you start immediately with phase two of love, which is romance. Let me go back a little bit about what does the word romance, or maybe better, where did the word romance come from? Anybody knows?
Roman.
From Rome. It started about 106 years, I believe, BC, before Christ, when the Roman Empire got big enough to decide to expand west, so they moved to the land of the Gaul, G-A-U-L-E, like Charles de Gaulle, the French president, Charles de Gaulle, meaning of the Gauls. The Gauls are people that are in current-day France, Belgium, Holland, and Luxembourg, or in modern technology, Europeans will know it's called France and Benelux. Holland, Belgium, and Luxembourg is Benelux. and the earth to speak the Gaulish language. Then the Rome went there, and they went in two levels of people. The commoner, where the Roman soldiers, they walk on foot, they carry their weapons, they wear the famous Romanian sandals. But they're led by the generals, which were from the upper class or aristocrat, aristo meaning better, rulers. And they were the head of the army, and they were cavalry. They used horses. And anybody knows what color were the horses for the Roman cavalry or the higher class? They were white, always white. So this army with these leaders on white horses start to go to France. Women in France at the time were living in a small, poor villages, and they were traded as a commodity. Whoever paid the most for you will marry you. You have no choice or opinion or whatever. Then suddenly they discover something else. They found a very handsome Italian man who has big muscles, because to be in the army, you have to have big muscles to be physically strong. And they were allowed to own properties and land, so were wealthy. They have big houses. So he's good looking, meaning he has good genes. Our instinct wants us to have good genes, have good children. He is big muscles. It must be that he has a lot of testosterone and can have a lot of children. He is wealthy, so I'm going to have the security. This is the one I want. And he used to come to the villages, invade it, and if there's a woman here and there that's particularly attractive, he would kidnap her and take her to his palace, where she will feel the experience of falling in love with him. And this is the source of the story, a prince coming in a white horse with a sword that will come and take me away from my misery and take me to real happiness. And we started to associate that feeling with the Romans. And the language, the Gallic language and the Roman language started to mix. The French language came, and the word was Romantique, meaning from Rome. I went to Germany in Bavaria, and there's something called the Romantique Road. It has nothing to do with love and romance. It was an old Roman trail called the Roman Road, so they still call it the Romantic Road. When they make a noun of that, it became romance. So romance, meaning a white prince, good-looking, big muscle, power, wealth, a sword that will come and take you away from your misery and give you happiness ever after. The English language added another word called falling in love. Have you ever wondered why we call it falling? Since what? Why that? Because it happened suddenly. You don't say on July 16, 2018, I'm going to fall in love. It doesn't happen. It just happens suddenly like a fall. And it's unexpected. You cannot say on a certain day, certain place is going to happen. You have no idea when and where, like the fall. If you know that you're going to fall, you're going to prevent it from happening. And it's forceful. You fall down, you break your wrist, you block your hip, there's a lot of force. When you fall in love with someone, it's very forcible, very powerful. And it's totally unavoidable. You cannot avoid a fall, or you wouldn't fall. It happens suddenly, bang, you fall with force, you break your arm and your leg, and you cannot make the fall. It wouldn't be a fall. The same with romance or falling in love. It's sudden, unexpected, forceful, intense, and unavoidable. So two words with the same meaning. So before we go through the speech, I want to give you my goals. What do I want to achieve, like a roadmap? And then we will go through the roadmap. So my goal is first to explain romance based on facts. We all got our education about romance from Disney stories, romance novel, Hollywood movies, which are not based on science. This is written by daydreamers or right imagination. And there are many myths about romance that I believe is hurting everybody in the society, And we need to understand and erase that. Unless we do that, we will continue to suffer and complain that love cannot be achieved, we are disappointed in love, and so on. So Ferris, is romance to love? Don't waste to believe that. Cinderella was a maid cleaning stairs and steps, went just once to a palace looking beautiful, looking very feminine. The prince on a white horse with power and palace just took a look in here and bang, he fell in love with her, or his three-brain part chooses her, so they start romance. And then what happened? And they live happily ever after. So just one event, you see the right person, you have happiness that will last you for a lifetime, that will never stop and end. Romance is true love, but is it? We have to look at that. Is the purpose of romance just to make you happily ever after, or is it for a different reason? It is a real purpose for the love or for romance more than just joy and happiness. We all expect that. I'm going to meet someone, I'm going to be in love, I'm going to be very happy ever. And if that doesn't happen, then I picked up the wrong prince or the wrong princess. Solution, get rid of them and look again for the correct prince. If that is the purpose of romance. Or maybe it has another purpose. And that leads us to the question. If the purpose of romance, then romance should last for a lifetime. If romance have a different purpose, then the purpose will be achieved one day and you don't need the purpose again. Many of us know about pregnancy. Has any woman ever got pregnant for a baby for 5 or 6 years? 2 years? 1 year? Why does it have to end up the 9 months? Because pregnancy has a purpose. To increase the baby from one cell to be big enough to survive out. And at that point, the pregnancy must end. It's not the baby yet. It's not the adult, independent person. But that phase has ended. We have to move to the next phase. Maybe the same with romance, maybe not. And then some interesting science claim that romance is based on just one chemical system in the brain. Even better, they believe that they found one center of the brain, the love center of the brain. They found that, took pictures, sent it to each and every newspaper, magazine, website, TV station, radio station, worldwide, and you all read about here is picture of the love center for the brain. So myth number 8, previous presentation, I discussed 7 different myths about love. And here I talk that, convince you that romance is not true love. Like pregnancy is not the baby. Pregnancy is just a phase for getting the baby. Can succeed and eventually have the baby, or it can fail. So we will prove you that romance is based on a set of chemicals called monoamines. And that true love is based in a completely and totally different set of chemicals called nonapeptides. The two are completely unrelated to each other, but they have some interaction between them. So say romance is a temporary phase, it's phase 2 of love. Phase 1 was mate selection, now we have romance. But romance must end, and you go to phase 3, and you end up eventually with phase 4 of love, which is true love. That's the phase of love that is based on nonapeptides. This is the phase of love that lasts for a lifetime. So true love, nonapeptide-based love, lasts for a lifetime. Romance does not, cannot, and will not last for a lifetime. Now let's look at these two people. They're 95 and 92. They got married 70 years ago. She wants to go swim at the beach, so he's taking her, holding her hand, holding his cane and her cane, and ask, if this is romance, 70 years ago they fell in love, had the monoamine that lasted until now, or this is true love, and now the brain is filled with a totally different brain chemical called nonapeptide. Which is which? This is true love, in my opinion. I don't know what you think. But to me, this is true love. So the chemical basis for that has to be the chemical basis for true love. Let's look back. What is romance? Let's look at features of romance. Do you ever keep every letter, every note, every present for the guy you fell in love with or the girl? You do. Isn't that a feature of romance? Yes. We call it in medicine hoarding, saving everything. Do you keep thinking about that person again? Yes, you will. I should be focused on my work. Oh my God, think about it. Stop it. I finished my work, and then you go back thinking about it. False thinking is called obsession. So you have some obsession with that person. It's a feature of romance. Do you keep texting him and calling him non-stop? I'm in a meeting, I'll be finishing, and okay, I wouldn't bother you. 10 minutes later, he's just, you can't, you have to text again. Anybody ever did that? This is called compulsion. Doing things again is your will. Calling when you shouldn't. Talking on them when you shouldn't. You just cannot stop it. Do you ever stay at night thinking about them and want to sleep? It's 10 o'clock by bedtime, it's midnight, and I'm still up thinking? Yes. We get insomnia as a manifestation of romance. Do we feel happy, ecstatic, very joyful when we are in love? Yes. We call it medically, this is euphoria. It's another feature of romance. Romance have multiple manifestations. And do we remember everything about your love and your romance with somebody? That got my attention accidentally a few years ago. When I had a patient who was like 92, sent for memory loss, and as I asked him a question, he didn't know if he has 3 children or 4 children. He has boys and girls. How many boys, how many girls, I'm not sure. One of my kids is a physician. What kind of physician, I don't know. Is he here in California, different state? I don't know. And I asked him, are you married? He said, yes, I'm married to Maria, the love of my life. And he started to sing me a song called Maria, Maria. So I had to ask him, tell me more about Maria, how you met, when, and when. And he told me everything in very fine details. He remembered meeting her, what she was wearing, what they danced on, in very fine details. But interestingly, he doesn't remember how many children he has. He doesn't remember which one of them was a physician. So romance is associated with very strong emotion. Many of us will remember the first kiss, but don't remember if last July you kissed or not. Many of us remember first time you have sex, but you don't remember a certain day you did not have it or not. So romance is associated with very strong recorded memory. And when you see the beloved, you start to feel your heart pumping strong. Yes, many people do that. That's called tachycardia, a beat. And when you see them, they feel sometimes jittery, sweaty, shaking. We call that sympathetic stimulation, another manifestation of romance. And what about if you see a mate talking to another competitive mate? The woman is talking to another man, then you start to feel afraid, oh my God, she's going to leave me now and go to that one, that's the end. Oh, suspicious, why is she talking to him? She doesn't love me anymore, that's it. Do you feel jealous? You sometimes feel that you want to almost hit the other person. I saw an experiment about that done on mice, and I was surprised. I have a female mice after mating with a male mice, then they introduce a new female mice. How violent she is, this tiny little thing. Try as hard as she can to physically kill the competition. I don't want you there. That's manifestation of romance. What about seeing your mate as extremely beautiful and handsome and perfect during romance? We do that. It's an illusion. I have a guy telling me that the woman he's in love with, who's 5 foot high, 200 pounds, looks exactly like Bo Derek. And he showed me a picture and I looked like, my God, what does she have to do with Bo Derek? Absolutely nothing. But he's totally convinced. His brain changed her image to be perceived by him as the perfect woman like Bo Derek. And this is an illusion. This is a feature of love. Sometimes you cannot see reality about your mate. When I was a resident, I got attracted because one of the residents working with me. She was doing pediatric neurology in her 16 years of after college education. She goes to a party one night and comes next day happy and euphoric and jumping. What's the matter with you? She said, I'm in love. I met somebody else today and that's it. Then later on I found out that the guy doesn't have any education. He has a school dropout. He works as a warehouse manager. Maybe that's not important at all. Then later on I found that he has been in and out from rehab because he's a cocaine addict. And then he has been in jail 5 times for theft in different ways. This guy is not for you. No, 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 no. Love changes everything. Now we are in love. All that is past will never happen again. Absolutely could not see the reality. She has delusion, a fixed false belief. It's not true that the cocaine addict, the guy in and out, will just change because he fell in love with her. But we could not convince her otherwise. It's no way. It's a delusion. And he started to pay very close attention to what the other person does. He went here, he did there, he walked over there, talked to that person. You pay close attention. We call it hypervigilance. These are typical features of romance. Anybody disagree? So, do we know how this happens in our brain? Yes, we know. And how do we know that? We knew that from a long time ago when a British guy decided to write a story about what he thought at the time, like everybody, that romance is love. So he went up to write a love story, so he went to watch a lot of people on romance. And then he came, his name by the way was William Shakespeare, and he was writing a story called Romeo and Juliet. And he said at the time that love is merely a madness. I have to say what he meant by love is romance, it's merely a madness. If there is a great similarity between madness and romance, is it true? Is it just an imagination? Schizophrenia, which typically called madness, have some features. You see them have a car loaded with boxes and things. You go to their house, you can walk in because they're retaining every piece of paper, not yes. Schizophrenics have hoarding. Doesn't romance have hoarding too? Yes. Do they have obsession, keep thinking about the same thing again and again and again? Yes, they do. Do they have compulsion, repeatedly doing the same thing again as they will? Yes. A few months ago, I saw a schizophrenic for a different reason, but he believed that his neighbor is putting poison gas in his trash can, so when he goes to open to put trash, he's going to get the poison, he's going to die, thinking about it all the time. Getting out the trash can, flipping it upside down and shaking it to get all the gas, put it back in. Going 2 hours later, he goes to do the same thing again and again. Almost all day and all night compulsion. Typical to the compulsion to text him and he can't stop it. Some similarity there. Do they get insomnia? They stay up, they couldn't sleep because they're thinking about the neighbors coming to poison me. What else is doing? How is he going to try to kill me? They get insomnia the same as those in love. Stay up all night thinking about the other one. Do they feel happy? Have you seen them walking, singing and dancing? And many know us, why are you happy? I don't know, it just happened. It's a feature of schizophrenia, similar to the euphoria of romance. Do they have paranoia? You know, schizophrenic have paranoia. They have unusual fear, suspiciousness. And when they're very frightened, the heart will beat fast. They have the sympathetic stimulation, they feel jittery, they sweat, the pupils dilate, all of that. Romantics do exactly the same. Do they have illusions? Where they see things different from reality? The guy in romance thinks the 5 foot, 250-pound woman looks like Bodevek. The schizophrenic say the birds talk to me and told me that the neighbors trying to poison me by pouring poison gas over there and so on. It's typical illusions. The pictures are talking to them and so on, typical of schizophrenia. Do they have delusions? I'm Napoleon Bonaparte, I invented this and that. They do, just like people in romance. Do they have hypervigilance? Yes, the guy I met was watching the guy coming in and out, and he apparently went to Costco put a bunch of bottles of milk. He looked at them, realized it's poison gas. They just masked that upon the Costco sells poison gas. And every time the neighbor gets in and out, he's paying close attention to them. You know the lover who watches the other one hide, see them coming and going, all they're doing? Same behavior. It's exactly the same. So we move. So is love based on one chemical system in the brain? Dr. Hawkins and Dr. Bonner felt yes, it's dopamine. Dopamine is just one chemical that causes all of that. So I tell you, that's not true. Love is not based on one chemical, dopamine. That's a myth. And Dr. Hawkins and Dr. Kokas published worldwide a finding about the love center in the brain, an area in the brainstem called the VTA, and insist this is the love center for the brain. Is it true? Is it false? We find that both schizophrenia and romance are caused by multiple chemical systems in the brain, not just dopamine. So let's study them one by one. In romance, we studied four chemical substances. In schizophrenia, we studied five. One's called NMDA, studied in schizophrenia, but not studied in romance yet. So as a result, I cannot use it to discuss that. So I focus on the other four, and they are called the monoamines. Monoamines is like a family name, the Smith family. And here in the Smith family, this is the Smith. They have two children, Michael and John. Michael has three children, epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine. John has no children. So the members of the family now are one, two, three, four. So let's look at them one by one and see what they can do to conclude whether love or romance is based on dopamine alone or it's more than that. First chemical we'll cover is called epinephrine. It's responsible for feeling suspicious, responsible for feeling fear. When you're frightened, you're releasing epinephrine. Responsible for feeling jealousy. Responsible for your heartbeat. And it's responsible for the long-term memory recall. Actually, just impressed about fear and long-term memory recall last spring. My daughter was doing a summer in Europe, so she was in London. I had a medical conference in Paris, so she took the train, came to visit me. When she was 6 years old, we went to Paris for 2 weeks, stayed in a hotel in a certain area. So I wanted to take her back to see what remembers about that. She walked around, couldn't remember anything until we went to a restaurant. She said, yes, I remember that place. You go downstairs to the left, you find the ladies' bathroom. And we sat on this table. Well, that's interesting. Why in particular do you remember that? She said, I remember that very distinctly. I said, I want to go to the bathroom. So I went down there, closed the door, used the bathroom. And trying to get out, open the door, it wouldn't open. Keep opening the door, it wouldn't. Felt scared. Started to scream, help, help, help. Nobody helped. Nobody responded. I kept screaming and knocking at the door at the end. Then I saw there's something higher up rattling. Discovered that the locking mechanism in Paris and France was different from the American thing. We have a latch higher up. She opened the latch, got out, came, was glad that we didn't leave. She thought, now we're going to leave and go away, pay and go away. She doesn't remember where the hotel is and would be lost. The fear caused her to remember in very fine detail the place. So fear can produce a very impressive long-term memory recall. I'm sure if you had a very stressful, fearful experience, you will remember easily. The anxiety, the shakiness, the sweating, the so on is caused by epinephrine. But is suspiciousness, fear, jealousy, fast beat, long-term memory and recall, anxiety, features of romance and schizophrenia? That's not dopamine, that's a different chemical. How could they say that? Another chemical is called norepinephrine. It's responsible for the loss of sleep, we see in romance. Responsible for the rapid heartbeat when you see the beloved. Increase attention to the mate, you pay attention to everything they do, features of both. You focus on one mate and ignore others. If you haven't selected a mate, every mate is a potential mate. Have to be scanned, screened to see if he's good or not. If not, you move to another one. Once you select a person, somebody comes in, you're not interested. I already made my choice, I already had one mass. It's a feature of norepinephrine. Dilated pupils, sweating, a feature of norepinephrine. These are features of a mass, but they have nothing to do with dopamine. The most important effect in my mind is that norepinephrine multiply non-peptide cells and its receptors. There's a different system called non-peptide, which I'll prove to you later on, that this is the one responsible for true love. And you have a certain number of cells and receptors, like a construction company that have five construction teams, each team is composed of five members. So the net effect for them is 25 people. If you use them for a month, you can maybe build a hut. Norepinephrine comes and makes the five teams 50 teams. And each team is not just out of five people, it's out of 50 people. So because it's effect in non-peptide, then non-peptide can build a big house, not just a hut. So norepinephrine help to make the non-peptide multiple and multiplying numbers because it is receptor. Next one is serotonin. We know serotonin causes obsession. You keep thinking again and again, it's serotonin, compulsion, doing something again. If somebody suffers from OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, how do we treat them? Give them medication that increase serotonin. But obsession and compulsions are not a feature of dopamine. If you give somebody dopamine, they don't become obsessive compulsive otherwise. Hoarding is a feature of serotonin, not that. And then, most important is it causes the non-peptide cells and receptor to multiply even more. So say now a 50 construction group, each one composed of 50, they become 200 construction, and each one is composed of 200 people. Now you can build not just a house, a big house. So adding that effect makes a difference in the future for the effect of the norepinephrine. Now dopamine is involved, no doubt about it. Joy, pleasure, ecstasy, happiness is caused by dopamine. No questions about it. Illusion, seeing something different from it is caused by dopamine. Schizophrenic has illusion, we give them dopamine, broken chemicals, it goes away, it gets better. Delusion. The alcoholic, cocaine addict is going to be a perfect human being because we are in love. It's caused by dopamine. Abnormal thinking. Schizophrenic have abnormal thinking. They're going to go for an interview to be a waitress at the montage, and they go there wearing a fur hat, a t-shirt, swimming, trunks, and flip-flops. You say, well, what kind of thinking is that? You're going for an interview to first-class place. The same with people in romance. The woman who believes that the drug addict, cocaine addict, whatever, will completely change, she will threaten him, she's not going to have sex with him for 1 week, and that's it. He'll immediately change and go back and be non-drug addict, non-cocaine addict, no crimes or going to jail, is abnormal thinking. That effect of dopamine. And another important effect is it causes further multiplication of the non-peptide cells in their receptors. Now we have 5,000 construction teams, each one is composed of 5,000 people. Now instead of building a hut without this say chemical, now you can build a big palace. Big difference between someone who lives in a hut, someone lives in a big palace. And the difference was the effect of three of different one. So in conclusion, romance manifestations are based on at least four chemicals, probably five or more, but we studied four. And that dopamine alone cannot explain all of that. Those who think it's just one thing alone. Now they say there's a location in the brain called VTA, for ventral tegmental area. It's a tiny area, like 1 millimeter, less than a head of a pin. But if that is the love center of the brain, and they told everybody, and now look at different romance reviews and so on, and brain science of romance, you know, it's VTA. But if this is the love center, if you damage it, shouldn't the love go away? If this is the source of my voice, and you take it away, my voice should disappear. Correct? So what happened to people that have stroke damaging the VTA? Do they forget loving the people they love? Do they change the love? Does anything different happen to their love? Absolutely nothing. So how could it be that this is the center for romance? This is the love center of the brain. It doesn't make sense. If this is the source of the sound, if you bring it closer, you get louder. They did deep brain stimulation of that area to see what happens. If you put the deep brain stimulation in the back of my brain on the left, I see flashing light on the right. 100% of the people, 100% of the time. If I put it in the motor cortex, my right arm will shake and jerk. 100% of the people, 100% of the time. When you go and stimulate the VTA to a bunch of people, what happened? Love doesn't increase. Love doesn't increase. Absolutely no change. Stimulate your appetite and say, I want to eat, I'm hungry. Can you get me something to eat? And that's it. How could that be the love center of the brain? If you damage it, stay the same love, stupidity, the same love, it's not. It's hocus pocus science. So really, what is the real purpose of romance? Why did nature put romance in us? They talk about drug main effect and drug side effects. A patient comes to see me and his blood pressure is very high. He says, no, that's dangerous, I'm going to give you medicine to lower your blood pressure. He didn't feel anything before from the high blood pressure. Didn't feel that medicine did anything, but it gave him dryness of the mouth. Dryness of the mouth is not the main purpose of the medicine. The main purpose is to lower the blood pressure. But from his perception, all happened is I went to the doctor, gave me this medicine that gave me dryness of the mouth. So he would believe that the purpose of the medicine is to give him dryness of the mouth, the so-called side effect of the chemical substance. So let's look at romance manifestation. Could the obsession, the compulsion, the euphoria, all of that be just side effects of these four chemicals rather than the main effect? Could the main effect be something else that we cannot see and feel? You know that three out of the four massively increase the non-apoptotic effect. Could romance be there to increase the non-apoptotic effect? Could it be preparing us for love? When true love comes, to be more intense, more durable, to last for a lifetime? Could romance be a preparatory phase for true love, like pregnancy is a preparatory phase for having a baby? Well, let's look at if romance can last for a lifetime or not. If the purpose of romance is happiness, then it should last for a lifetime, we should just continue to be happy. But if it's for a specific purpose, which is to multiply the non-apoptotic cell to the maximum number, then once you hit a point when you cannot multiply it anymore, cannot produce its effect anymore, you don't need it. Like the pregnancy achieved its goal, now time to end and move to live. So, if romance is for achieving a goal, then once the goal is achieved, it should stop. Romance should not last for a lifetime. And we see that love, romance does not. Do you have any cultural observation that over the years we noticed about romance effect on true love? Anybody knows? Anybody heard this? You can marry for love, you can marry for money, but you cannot have both. For centuries we noted that people who have romance eventually have true, durable love and they're happy for the rest of their life. And people that just choose somebody by the new brain only for some benefit never achieve true love. And many patients coming to tell me they married someone for a reason or the other, but never fell in love with them. They've been married for 50, 60 years, they still don't feel the true love. So what's the difference? When you marry for love, you have all three brain parts involved, the unconscious brain, the limbic brain, the reptilian brain, and the new brain. All of them have involved. When they are, kicks in romance. When you have the period of romance, you increase the non-apoptotic effects, you end up having true love later on. While those that marry for money use only the conscious brain, and we know that if you use the conscious brain only without the unconscious brain, romance will not happen. Nun aber that will not multiply, and as a result, true love will never happen. We'll continue to have the ability to just build a hut as opposed to somebody building a big palace. This is romance. Let's look at a bit about piece of romance. You know, some people fall in love at first sight. I call it, it's really a romance. See somebody bang their romance, like the resident with me went to a party, came back, madly in love, and that's it. Some people take them a while, a few months, before they fall in love. So what's the difference? What happened to each one? Those suddenly fall in love have a very strong unconscious brain. And unconscious brain works by template matching, genetic template matching. And as a result, it's quick. And if they have a weak conscious brain, doesn't contribute that much, then I don't need it. I made the decision, I'm ready to move in to romance. While those that take longer time to fall in romance, they have a strong unconscious brain that chooses the mate, but they have a strong conscious brain that wants to think and analyze and find more about that, and conscious brain is slow. You have to answer 20 questions in an exam, it takes you 4 or 5 hours, because thinking takes time. Analyzing people in conscious brain takes time. So people that have more involvement or contribution of the new brain takes longer time to decide. Then the same Dr. Hocus and Pocus came with the conclusion that love is addiction, because they believe that dopamine causes addictions, and if love is based on dopamine, then love is an addiction. Is it true? Tell you the truth is, love is not based on dopamine alone. We already discussed that. It's at least four different chemical substances, not just dopamine. Dopamine is one of them. A substance addiction is towards dopamine. If somebody is addicted to cocaine because he wants the release of dopamine in the brain, can he replace cocaine with a substance like apomorphine that releases as much or more dopamine in the brain and he will be happy and doesn't need the cocaine anymore? It doesn't happen. So it just cannot be the dopamine alone. I say it's like you feel cold, you want to eat, to have heat, you want matches to light the fire. So yes, matches are the first step, but you're not addicted to the matches. Because next time you're cold and shivering, they give you thousands of matches, you're still cold. It doesn't matter. You're not addicted to the matches. You're not addicted to dopamine. Dopamine causes other effects, which produces the heat, and you're addicted to the heat. You're addicted to many emotions associated with addiction, not just dopamine. If you take addictive substance and you take too much, you can die. Have you ever heard of cocaine overdose? Morphine overdose? Whatever overdose, it can kill you. But who have heard of love overdose? Anybody had a friend who had to be admitted for too much love or had too much love? What is the same? It's dopamine, it's an addiction. Too much of love should kill you. I haven't met anybody yet, if you don't tell me. And if you suddenly stop cocaine or morphine, people go through a life of fatal withdrawal symptoms. I treated many people and many patients that died because of withdrawal of drugs. Do we ever treat them by giving them dopamine? Have you ever heard of some movie star or famous person was going through withdrawal and went to the hospital, gave them dopamine, and that stopped it? Doesn't make a difference because they are not addicted to dopamine. What about love? If suddenly your lover disappears, does anybody get sick, have life-threatening situation, have to go to the hospital? It doesn't. It's not the same thing.